It's my pleasure to introduce the moderator of this morning's playwrights panel. South Coast Rep is one of the fortunate beneficiaries of a grant from the Mellon Foundation, which has enabled us to hire Julie Van Wyatt to be on our staff for 3 years as a playwright in residence. Where she's going to be doing a variety of duties and responsibilities in that capacity, a lot of them having to do with audience engagement. But one of her first public official duties is to moderate this morning's panel with most of the playwrights whose work is being represented at the festival this morning. Our relationship with Julie goes back a number of years. Mine goes back to when I was working at the Tabor with Pier Carlo Tolenti, and Julie was a member of our writers' workshop there. And then we have produced My Wandering Boy here in the Segerstrom. Was that part of the festival?
It was, yes.
It's part of an earlier festival. And then we did her play The Happy Ones in the Yardbirds Theater a couple of years ago. And now she's here on our staff making many valuable contributions, I'm sure, beginning this morning, Julie.
Oh, great. Well, I just want to welcome you all. I just want you to also know we're being live streamed, that is the word, on HowlRound, which is being broadcast at Emerson. So there are people probably watching live who are up and awake. And it will be available later on their website. So just to let you all know about that. I'm really happy to be here to have these five playwrights of the seven playwrights, 3 days. And I would love it if you would all introduce yourselves and the play that you wrote that is yours in the festival.
Hi, my name is Greg Moss. I wrote Reunion.
I'm Zoe Kazan. I wrote Trudy and Max in Love.
I'm Michael Hollinger. I wrote Hope and Gravity, but I'm happy to answer questions on behalf of Bo Willimon, even though I don't know him.
What was it like to work with George Clooney? My name is Noah Heidel. I wrote Smith Ball.
And I'm Carla Ching, and I wrote Fast Company.
Well, I'm really excited to have everyone sitting here and you get to see their faces, because I feel like sometimes as a playwright at these festivals, unless you see their name tag, you don't often get to see who wrote the play, and we don't get to hear why they wrote the play and what was the inspiration for the plays that you see. So I'm going to ask each of them to just talk about what inspired these plays. Was it an image, an idea, experience? So I don't know who wants to start.
Greg Moss.
Greg. All right. So Reunion was begun. Often a way I begin plays is that I have an idea of character and voice, but I also start from an idea of structure, and I'm interested in genre. So I was interested in this idea. There's a sort of tradition in American theater writing of these sort of male plays of Shepherd and Mamet, and you know, from Across the Pond, Pinter. So I was interested in that as a genre, how men interact in these sort of like claustrophobic situations. So I was kind of adapting that form, but also thinking like, what can I do to contribute or subvert that form too? So I think it's always a matter of setting certain structural limitations and then plugging in my personal material into it. And you know, as a theme, I'm constantly interested in the way men interact, the way men front with each other, the way men show love for each other. So I think that was, for me, the seed, the nut I was trying to crack. And also, my father gave me a short story by Nathaniel Hawthorne, in which a group of 80-year-olds are given this potion, which makes them young again for about 2 hours, and they end up making exactly the same mistakes they made when they were kids. And something about that repetition, that compulsion to repeat bad behavior seemed interesting to me, too.
That was interesting.
Yeah.
I did my best.
Daniel Longsorgan there, too. Yeah.
I've read a few things.
Nathaniel Hawthorne, whose grandfather was one of the people who was in the Crucible, and he put the W in his name to so people wouldn't know that he was related to that person.
Didn't know that, did you?
Yeah.
I did. I have learned something.
Anyone else?
Noah's next.
you. let's see. The inspiration. I have two friends. I had their. Now I don't. They're good. That was funny. and I thought they were funny guys, and so I wrote a fetus scene. I wrote a scene in a womb, so they would have somewhere funny to be. And there were a lot of fart jokes, and they peeped at each other and stuff like that. And then it became something very different. So it started out as a reason to have two friends have somewhere to be funny, and then it became something, for me, exploration of whether it's good to live or not. And so from fart jokes to there. that was it.
So it started with that scene.
Yeah, that's it. Yep.
That one to go on for 20 minutes.
Really?
Yeah.
Okay.
A little more anyway, because that plays about more. Where you got to at the end of that was where it got interesting. How do you get from fart jokes to that?
That's where I live, man. I don't know. That wasn't the question.
I couldn't take
this.
Ask a more specific question.
Well, you know, when you're dealing with age and exceptional age and birth and death and the nature of family and the nature of what it means to be a sibling and a child and a parent and follow personal imperatives versus parent imperatives of responsibility for family, those are vast.
Yeah, no.
Farts, you know, or...
No, for me, it's a straight line. Farts on what you just said. Yeah. That's creativity. I don't know.
What inspired you, Michael?
Yeah, I agree. Yeah. That sounds like a great play.
This has become like a reality show.
Delighted by anthology plays, so, you know, the All in the Timings and the Almost Mains, but also frustrated with them. I mean, I like the variety that they offer. I like the notion that you enter a different world each time the lights come up, but I also always had an irritation about them because your experience is very different from your experience of a full-length play, which ideally gives you a deepening experience of characters and predicaments and a deepening sense of the thematic concerns, and so that you feel weight at the end of an evening of a good full-length play that you don't feel at the end of an evening of short things. So I started thinking, part of it was a cynical beginning, really. It was like, gosh, I've got all these 10-minute plays. I wonder if I could recycle them. And that would be easy. I could save a lot of work that way. So I began writing short plays to connect them, and they began to emerge non-chronologically, connected by these elevator stories. And as I began to hear them aloud in readings and revise them, I kept pulling out more and more of the previously existing material and writing new pieces, because I recognized that the values of the full-length play, the deepening values and the increasing weight of the play, was much more satisfying to an audience. Even an individual scene that really nailed it something, if it didn't feel like it contributed deeply to the narrative and this sense of accrual, then it had to go. So that's been, you know, the irony and the joke on me is that it's been way harder in some ways than a full-length play, because I've had to, you know, tear out, put back in, tear out, put back in, tear out, put back in. I also recognize that was the big game. That's what I was interested in, and I'm not, and you don't see it very often, so it's exciting as a formal device to try to see, is it possible for a play to be both a wave and a particle, to feel like its increments are individually satisfying, like a 10-minute play, but that also build together so it feels like a full experience.
That's the best answer I've ever heard to that question. I was like, amazing.
I was like, that's
incredible. Carla?
This is the easiest job ever.
don't undercut yourself. Yes.
So I think a lot of people have asked me since I've been here why, you know, and I've sort of said, you know, my mom was a really tough lady. she didn't leave me in Long Beach or anything and tell me to get home, but
it's okay, we can talk about it.
I wanted to really, like, I write my plays to answer things for myself, things that I don't understand about the world. And one thing I didn't understand is why she was so tough. So I was like, what was she trying to teach me? And what did I learn over the course of that? Mm. So it was that, and like some Chinese American families, we are all gamblers, literally. we would do family reunions in Vegas. We would do potlucks where everybody knows how to play, you know, whether it's mahjong or poker or blackjack. Like, I learned how to count playing blackjack. So I just thought that that's how the world was. I didn't know that.
Do you split eights?
I do split eights.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Nice.
Yeah. Yeah. No. So that's. So I wanted to sort of be in a familiar world and do a family story that is fun, because family stories are usually not fun. They're grim. So yeah.
Wow. Good answer as well. Sorry, Kazan.
Sorry. Yeah, but can I ask one more question first?
Yeah.
Yeah.
But, okay, so why did you make them half-siblings, not full-siblings?
Because I'm also interested in the idea of not having blood obligation, that you choose each other, that you could walk away, but what if you know, you choose to be with them? So
yeah.
that's kind of why I did that.
Yeah,
no,
that's great. I similarly to Michael had a formal interest, which developed into a thematic interest, which was that my first two plays were much more traditional in their structure, like two acts in one location and like Aristotelian unity, and I was just really tired of like getting people on and off stage. I just got so bored with it, and found myself like writing all this interstitial material just to like get to the next moment that I really wanted to write. So I was like, what if I just wrote the parts that I want to write and just didn't write all the parts that are boring to me? So that is like where the first like part of it came from, and like I have a real aversion, not to be like a snob, but I do. I have a real aversion to plays like my own, where you move location a lot. I feel like, why not just write like a TV show? Like, so I didn't want to write a play in which we move location a lot and where you had short scenes, unless I was going to frame it within some thing that felt like it has to be in the theater. And for me that was, and I know this wasn't totally clear in my reading, but there's no set for my play, like it's just a black box theater, and I wanted it to look like a rehearsal room. Like there are like rehearsal tables with props on them and wigs or hats or whatever people want, and that like everything you see is what you get, and that there are like rehearsal folding chairs and you know, and that those make up the furniture of the place, and that, you know, I was also thinking about how like the logic of an affair is sort of like the logic of being in the theater space, where once you enter, all the rules are different than in your normal life, and you're allowed to like fall in love with people that you aren't allowed to fall in love with in the outside world, and once you leave, it's over, and all you have is a memory of it. So that's sort of where the like big thought came from, and then the specific thought came from feeling like being a young person and feeling like I've just been lied to about the nature of adult love my entire life, and that it's like so much more complicated than anybody ever told me, and that I just wanted to write about that and sort of write about that in a way that didn't judge the characters or take a moral stand, because I feel like that's not how people actually are. That's just how people are when they're judging other people.
And were you concerned that by just setting it in a black box that all the theaters who would be considering it would say, we have all this set design money, what are we going to do with it?
I was hoping they would just give it to me. Yeah.
more money to have a tree grow on Noah Heidel's stage.
Yeah. Yeah. Thanks for that. Okay.
So please give and give generously to the tree grow on Noah Heidel's stage fund.
Well, that leads me to my next question, actually, about how much, like, where are you all in your plays? You know, that...
These plays?
That we saw here. I mean, that you both spoke to, particularly... This was your, you know, wanting to deal with your mother and talking about love, and how, where do you feel like you all are exercised or expressed, or where do you live in these plays? And I think you both kind of spoke to that, but I'm also wondering if you feel that you hide yourself in your plays, or you expose yourself in your plays.
Hide.
Hide.
Oh. That's the point of hiding. I don't actually know. Michael?
Well, Noah starts out working with an idea.
What was it like to work with George Clooney?
I actually think that all playwrights start from essentially one pole. That there are, I mean, because I'm a teacher and I've taught students for many, many years, that there's this, an essential movement. There's, you know, Tennessee Williams writing Glass Menagerie and saying, I had an experience and I need to, and the movement is from experience to fiction. Mm-hmm. And that's one kind of challenge. And the Tom Stoppards and Noah Heidels of the world and Michael Hollingers and others begin with
Bo Willman.
I can't speak for Bo, but there are other writers who say that thing over there is really cool. Let me see what that is. And the process of doing that forces the opposite journey, which is say, how do I bring it to me? Mm-hmm. And it's the same as actors. Mm-hmm. Actor, there are external to internal actors and internal to external actors. We'll speak to that. Yeah, I mean, depending on the part's relative proximity to you.
Yeah. What about you, Gregory?
I think, sort of piggybacking on what Michael said, I feel like if you set up these formal or theoretical challenges, mm-hmm. then it allows me to, like, open my heart into the play. You know what I mean? Like, I feel safe once I have a little bit of distance from it. Mm-hmm. So I definitely feel it's self-revelatory, but once I have mm-hmm. created the place for that stuff to go mm-hmm. and make sense, you know? Mm-hmm. Yeah, I feel like they're not literally me speaking, but I am empathic with all the characters mm-hmm. when you know, throughout the play. Mm-hmm. Like, yeah.
That's the word, I think, the empathy word is, there is at some point an identification with everybody, and sometimes the character that's closest to me is the 72-year-old woman, 72-year-old African-American woman, that. And it's a great secret to have, to say, oh, I took a piece of my heart and I put it mostly in her, and nobody will expect to find it there. And they'll look for, like, the middle-aged writing professor.
You just told it everyone. Now we're gonna know your secrets. That's why you say hide and then look down. So no one knows.
Wait, can I ask a question? The one that's closest to you, is that the hardest to write or the easiest to write?
I find hardest because the writing the person that's closest to you, it's so easy to fall into the trap of this person's worldview is right, and then there's all these interesting, quirky, obsessive people around them. And we've all read lots of plays like that, right? We go, playwright character, everybody else.
That's a great point,
found that bizarrely that the most successful characters in the plays are ones where I go, like, I don't know where you're talking from, but I'm going to take dictation now. Mm-hmm. And I have no right to know how your life experience comes out like this, but that's the great mystery, right, where you go, I don't know how that's happening, but I'm not going to mm-hmm. question it too much in case it stops.
Right, right. Anyone else speak to that? Well, I guess I also want to ask, so what is different about writing now in 2013? Than any other time. What makes this time special?
For the theater?
Yeah. As a playwright, what themes, as opposed to, say, 2 years ago, 4 years ago, or 8 years ago for 20 for some of us are older. What makes this different?
I think some of it is what Zoe was talking about with her play, is that we're such a image-based, media-saturated society that what theater can do is strip that down, actually, and engage the audience's imagination and collaborate with them. That's not a thematic thing, but I think it's something that is sorely missing in the culture that theater does, that nothing else really does in the same way. And the sense of doing that in a community, in the community of an audience, is kind of amazing, I think. Mm-hmm.
I mean, like, I don't really know about writing. I'm going to speak as an audience member, which is that I think that, like, movies used to be a communal experience that everyone had, and recently people just, like, watch them on their computers at home, and that's really sad to me as somebody who loves movies, but, like, you can't do that with theater. You can't, like, import it into your laptop and take it home. And that the thing of, like, witnessing something as a group and having a group experience that is larger than yourself is something that I think is, like, essential to being human, and that it would be, like, devastating to lose for, like, cultural reasons, but also for, like, reasons of like, believing that other people are human, too.
Mm-hmm.
And that is something that, like, even when I'm like, ugh, I, like, hated that play so much, I like, I had that experience in a group, and that yeah,
we shared that.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's like pain. I actually think it's like painful in some way to go to the theater. Like, I think that it's like, I think I can count on my fingers the times when I've gone to, like, that. Over the course of my life that I can remember seeing a play and having a totally transcendent experience. And that is why I go to the theater all the time, is because, like, you had, like, five good hits, you know? And that I was talking to Mark Masterson about this, like, weirdly, though, the things I also remember really well are the things that were, like, that I hated or that were, like, felt like total failures to me, that I can still, like, remember those things. Mm-hmm. And that the stuff in the middle is the stuff that I kind of forget, the stuff that was sort of, like, good or I had a fine time. And that is also, I think that, like, being forced to sit there and you can't check your phone and you can't, like, play Spider Solitaire online while you watch TV, and, like, you have to concentrate and you're forced to pay attention, that, or fall asleep. But that's good.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, believers still go to church even though they've only had a religious experience a few times.
Right. Yeah, and people keep having sex, even though.
So we've gone there.
Yeah.
Okay, so, is that the next question?
Yeah.
Well, did anyone else want to speak to that? What, I mean, politically, does it change? Environmentally, what's going on? I mean, could these plays that we saw here be performed at another time, say? Do you feel like they speak to where we are now? Huh? Well, I mean, it's
a good
back question.
Back in time, not forward in time.
Back.
No, yours is going to be really good in 2089. It's a hit. It's a hit.
Awesome. I was born to be posthumous.
Like, what would a dramaturg find about this era of
us as playwrights?
Yeah.
Well, I mean, sadly, our generation has been taught to do less with more, or more with less, the opposite. You know, I think it's a specific challenge for us actors. There's no spear carriers anymore. And, not like, I think if Streetcar Named Desire was written today, it'd be four characters.
Mm-hmm.
It'd be Mitch, you know. And they're, that's just a economic reality of our generation. And either you can accept that or say, fuck it. Ooh, can I say that? Good morning, Emerson College.
Sorry, can I ask a question, piggybacking on that?
Piggy.
Like, Michael, I know that for this reading we had, like, doubling of characters. In ideal world, without any strictures, would you have those all be played by different people?
It's interesting. I've written another play called Red Herring that has 18 roles in it, played by 6 actors.
Right, but that's, like, a thing that people... Sorry, go ahead.
Right. So and I've seen it done as 6 in professional theaters, and seen it done as 18 in universities and things. And And I've seen a reading of Hope and Gravity with 10 actors, with one person per role. And both of them were felt utterly valid to me.
Huh.
The one with the larger cast incarnation feels like, wow, there's an entire world. All these people are individual. And the one with the doubling says, wow, these actors are astonishing. They are transformative. And so the doubling version is just more theatrical and more self-conscious.
Right.
And the other is a little more textured and broad. But I've liked them both.
Right, but I'm sorry, I'm not articulating my question well enough. Like many playwrights, out of necessity, like I in my play, like are forced to think in a meta-theatrical
yes.
way in order to justify having one actor play multiple parts.
Right.
But like, do you feel that it is like to the play we saw, to Hope and Gravity? Do you feel like it's intrinsic to the play, or do you feel like it's something that was like imposed by the necessity to think meta-theatrically?
That's a great question, and it's almost impossible for me to think clearly on it, but certainly I would not have undertaken a 10-actor play blithely.
Right.
And I have written plays of 10 to 12 mm-hmm. characters, and I don't undertake them blithely. So I almost certainly the doubling convention was derived from the notion, all right, how can this be a good rather than a debit, or rather than an impediment to it being produced?
Mm-hmm. Right. I also think that, like, I don't know if you guys feel this way, but, like, being an actor myself, that, like, I want to give every actor enough to do.
Yeah. Yeah,
and
yeah,
that,
yeah.
like, that's, like, a wonderful thing about giving them multiple parts, yeah. is that you're like, okay, well, like, I wonder if I would feel the obligation to make that character more important to the play if I didn't give that actor something else to do.
Right. Well, there's something astonishing about a curtain call where you've seen something, mm. like something in the Angels
yeah,
in America.
Yeah.
You get to the end of it and you go, my God, 8 actors? How is that possible? It is wondrous.
Right.
And everybody earns their paycheck
yeah.
big time.
Yeah.
Like that.
Well, I wanted to open it up to questions for the audience, for the playwrights, because we could sit up here all day together, but I wanted to see if anyone had any questions they wanted to bring up that came from this weekend, that are burning in their mind.
The hands, man. Just who to call on.
What have you learned about your plays through this weekend's process?
That's a great question. So for anyone that didn't hear that, was what have you learned through this weekend's process about your plays?
I learned that I'm done with it. In a way that's necessary. I wasn't part of the reading series, and I haven't been to see my play since opening night. And I came back, and it was it belonged to the actors, and mm-hmm. I saw it, and it looked like a neat play, but it really didn't feel part of me anymore.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I learned. That I'm done.
Hmm. Just for people that are watching this on the web, Noah's was a full production. We do 2 full productions and then 5 readings in the series. So Noah's was a production, and the rest here were readings. So that would be a good question for others. Did you all make a lot of changes to your plays during this process?
I made a lot of changes, actually, here.
I saw a lot of different colors in your...
Okay, so these colors... Each color is for a different set of rewrites. So that's the work that we did. We did that, but I also just learned where, you know, hearing it with the audience, where I still need to cut what can go away.
Mm-hmm.
So that was super useful.
Mm. That's great. That's very impressive. You should just frame that.
This is going to be good in a posthumous way.
I tried not to change anything because in so short a rehearsal time, I don't want to give the actors a moving target.
Mm-hmm.
But I definitely have a lot of homework that I'm taking away with me. I think it's hard to give a simple answer to that because I think I have to process what occurred
mm-hmm.
in the performance first. But it was definitely informative. I think an audience is really the best teacher for these things.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I am like a, an all too willing rewriter. Like, I think it comes from being an actor. Like, I just like take a note immediately and I don't process it most of the time. And I think I've like damaged my first two plays by not being like enough of an advocate for my original impulse. So I went into this very like careful, like very cautious, and feeling like I needed to like be the most stubborn person in the entire world and not be such a freaking people pleaser. So I like tried to shut up a lot more and not try to like fix actor problems by making changes. I rewrote like 3 pages probably over the course of the last 4 days, and I probably feel like I have like 3 more pages to rewrite. I don't.
Which ones? I like 42.
Yeah. 98 to 101.
I like it.
Weirdly, the 3 pages I rewrote before. I think I need to do a tiny bit more work.
98 to 101 is always hard.
Always hard. Yes, and I made adjustments to make Max's case stronger in their breakup argument, and now I think I need to work a tiny bit more for her, because before she had a much stronger argument than him. I learned that the humor in my play is not so idiosyncratic. I was not expecting people to laugh, and then people laughed a lot. And I was like, oh, I just get nervous sometimes that like the thing that's funny to me in my head is like not going to be funny to anybody else. Yes, I'm not alone.
I've seen a lot of readings of this play, unusually for me, and in all different incarnations with different actors and different pieces in it. So I have a kind of spreadsheet in my head, which is very perplexing, of you know, where it worked, when it worked, how it worked, who read it. And so there's a high watermark of the success of each individual scene and of the play as a whole. So, you know, that's mapping against my experience of any individual reading. For me, the values that I looked at most closely and still am looking at closely are, how do the changes tip the play toward one of two values? Its comic devices, which are rather powerful at times, and its inclination to fall, to reveal human brokenness, to fall into the belly. And the play is asking, as my friend Aaron, who directed this, knows a phrase that we now both share is ha-ha, ouch, the dramatic rhythm of that. So, you know, as I continue to work on it, and this includes this version, discovering like, oop, too much, a little too much ha-ha, not enough ouch, oops, too much ouch, not enough ha-ha. And I think I'm going to be swapping out some of these pieces and replacing them with others again in the next incarnation. May I piggyback on your question slightly?
Piggy.
What's
she going to say? No.
Sorry, no. That was a perfect question.
It is a perfect question, and something I'm extremely interested in.
It was a question for those who maybe didn't hear about the actors and the casting in their plays. She was saying how wonderful it was and how they responded to the seeing the actors perform their plays.
Like, I am very curious in, like, how, if it is a good thing, and if it is, how one does it to actor-proof a play. Mm-hmm. And that is the way that I would like to piggyback on that question to my fellow playwrights.
I don't think you can.
Because I think sometimes you get like an amazing stroke of casting, and that person is exactly what you pictured in your head, or better. But a lot of the time, you're like, even if you have a really great actor, you're hitting a thing where you're like, they don't have that essential quality, and it's not their fault, because they're a person, and they're bringing all of their humanity to this, and they're really good at it, what they're doing, but they're never gonna bring that thing.
And, like, I've had the experience.
Are you talking about Chris Messina?
Perfect. Yes. Terrible. He's terrible.
Terrible.
Shit. Never going to be good in that part, ever. I've had the experience. And I've had the experience of an actor of being in something and being like, I'm making this work for you, but I have a suspicion that there's a giant hole in your play that I'm covering by doing this over here.
Was it Angels in America?
Yes, that one. Giant hole. You know what I'm saying, though, that, yeah. Like, as a playwright, too, you've, like, sometimes you lean on an actor, but, like, what, how, what, yeah.
I think it's different from play to play. I feel like with this particular piece, I was trying to write something that was open enough that an actor who was game and inventive could put their stamp on it. I wanted to write something that was a three sort of big types that an actor could inhabit and make their own. I think there is always a dance with actors in terms of conveying the line I heard in my head and the literal music and rhythm of that and the way they're giving it. But I think it's also this is part of it's the vicissitudes of this art form. You have to deal with other human beings and let them do what they do. So I don't have a pat answer except for that there's a dance that goes on in the rehearsal room and you try to make it work for everybody, you know? Yeah.
Anyone else want to answer to that?
I mean, I always get Jackie Chung when I can because she will magic moments. I mean, is it, because it's a collaborative art form, is it an okay thing that we help each other sometimes?
I think so. Yeah. I just mean, like, how do you make the play sturdy enough that you don't have to lean? Like, that you don't need that perfect actor? Like, that's sort of what
is
I mean.
It possible?
Like, yeah, I don't know. I don't know. That's why I asked. I mean, how do you guys address that? How do you feel about that?
I don't think I've never found that as possible, but
I think the one thing that I feel is true is that great roles are also really hard. Mm. It's like composers don't write easy to sing arias. Mm. They write really freaking hard arias that singers have to rise to the challenge of. And when they do, we're astonished because it's like watching Cirque du Soleil. And the hardest roles, the roles that the actors gnash their teeth about and go, how am I supposed to do this, are the ones that they rise to the challenge of and astonish us with. So I don't know how to put that as an imperative. I've just discovered that to be true. And oftentimes in the casting process, we'll go, yeah, they're not quite right. You know, she's 4'8" and the character's supposed to be 6', but, you know, we'll make it work. And then suddenly, you know, you have a performance where you go like, wow, that little firecracker had such scale, you know, and suddenly it's very impactful. Whereas maybe if you had somebody who was an exact fit,
right. That
the striving towards the role would not have been so great.
That's a great answer.
Yeah, no shit.
Yeah.
Okay.
I love that. I love the idea that, like, writing something challenging is the imperative. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Make your collaborators work hard.
Yeah, that's
this play. This play, Red Herring, is very... has to be solved, its design has to be solved by a really, really smart director and designer.
Right.
And they start the process always going like, and they get to the end of the process, if they've solved it, being brilliant.
Mm.
And like winning awards because they've solved it. Because it's
so
hard,
cool.
But it forces them to be hard. Just like the Queen of the Night aria.
That's
forces
easy.
A singer to sing.
You want me to do it right now?
Yes.
Okay.
Ladies and gentlemen. And
Mr. Bo Williman.
We have time for one more question in the back there.
When you're writing secrets and lies in the character, how do you approach revealing the truth when the character is still telling the truth in the story?
It's a secret. You gotta take Michael's class, apparently. I want to take your class. Dude, you're a good teacher. I bet. Are you a good teacher? Oh, no, shit. Zoe? No comment from the playwright.
Carl, did you?
No, I don't know if I understand the question.
Yeah, I don't know.
The different characters
bury a good secret, and then I don't know. If you bury the good secret.
I'll give you the answer that I can understand. Characters use an abundance of language to hide things, and then they use silence to hide things. So sometimes overselling the story, overselling the lie is a way to indicate, it tells the audience and is a way to withhold something, actually. To talk too much can be that, I think, you know? Mm-hmm. So that's one sort of very technical answer, yeah.
I think there are a lot of plays, I don't know, just like from what I see, I feel like there are a lot of plays being written right now where like the dramaturgical trick of the play is that there's some piece of information that we don't know for most of the play, and that the audience's job, like the dramatic event is the unveiling of that thing. So I think there are a lot of ways to skin a cat, and that there are a lot of people writing in that way now, so audiences are getting savvier about it, so writers have to work harder.
Great. Well, Kent, did you have a quick? No, go for it.
No, go ahead.
We have one for, squeeze one more in here.
Just have one question. So how do you know at the end of your creative process that you have made a good play? Not a successful one, because success is not determined by yourself. How do you know that you write a good one? Because play is so interactive. You have an audience, you have actors, and you don't get good directors, and not a lot of money for the set. How do you know that you really, truly
I don't think any of us love ourselves. Total self-loathing.
It's a prerequisite of the job to not love yourself.
Yeah.
So that was the final question was, how do you know when you've written a good play? do you?
What's that?
Maybe we should.
Right.
I'm gonna answer this just by telling you like one anecdote, which is that my last play, I was like 3 weeks into rehearsal and called my parents, and I was like, I don't know how anyone writes like an okay play. Like, it is so hard just to like write an okay play. Like, good play, great play that people will want to do in 2 years. I can't even begin to understand how you make, like, I have no clue. And my dad, who has been writing for like 40 years, was like, yeah, no one knows.
I'll try. It's a really strange thing that we do for a living. All of you and many other people watch something that we love, and you have to love something to watch people watch it. And so at some point, how do you know that it's good? It doesn't, it's something that you love, and you can't apologize for anything that you love. And so I feel that everyone here loves what they put on stage. And so at some point, you have to disassociate from other people's reactions and be in love with that thing. And it doesn't matter. I mean, it's like when you bring a girlfriend home to mom and dad. You know, the you're having dinner, and then that person goes to the bathroom, and you say, so what did you think? And that, no, and that validation makes you feel good or bad, but at the same time, it doesn't matter. Like, you love that thing with all your heart, and people saying good, bad, and different, like, is immaterial at some point. And so that's how you know you did something good, when you feel in love.
That is an excellent note to end
on. I agree. Okay.
I just want to thank you all for being amazing playwrights and panelists and just sharing your thoughts and hearts today. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.